Hello guys, welcome back. Let's continue our topic about sedation and analgesia in the ICU. First analgesic on our list is the fentanyl, one of the synthetic opioids we used in the ICU, and it's under Schedule 2 of the controlled drugs. It is indicated for moderate to severe pain and for continuous opioid analgesic therapy. The action of the fentanyl is like other opioids. It binds to opioid receptors in the central nervous system, altering the response to and perception of pain, therefore produces analgesia effects. Fentanyl has surpassed morphine as the most popularly used opioid analgesic in the intensive care units. It has several advantages over morphine, including a faster effects or onset of action. This is due to the fact that fentanyl is 600 times more lipid-soluble than morphine. In other words, it has a high capability of dissolving in fats, oils, or fatty tissues. Because of this high affinity to adipose tissue, it has low tendency to remain in the vascular compartment. Therefore, it has low tendency to accumulate in our body. Alright. Fentanyl can be administered intravenously, intramuscularly, or by transdermal, but in the ICU, we often give the drug via IV. The onset is immediate with a duration of 5 minutes to 1 hour, mainly metabolized by liver and excreted mostly via urine and some from feces. The dosage of bolus is ranging from 25 microgram to 100 microgram or 0.5 to 2 microgram per kg. For continuous IV infusion, it's ranging from 25 microgram to 200 microgram per hour or 0.5 to 2 microgram per kg per hour. Let's talk some of the adverse effects of the fentanyl. So, when we assess the patient, we use the head-to-toe systemic assessment, right? Let's do the same in assessing and remembering the adverse effects of the drugs we are administering. So, central nervous system, the adverse effects are confusion, sedation, weakness, dizziness, restlessness. This is because fentanyl or the opioids depressed central nervous system. Alright? Then respiratory system. It can cause apnea, bronchoconstriction, laryngospasm, and respiratory depression. Opioids like fentanyl can depress respiration by a number of mechanisms and neuronal sites of action. One example is the respiratory center in the brainstem. Both hypoxic and hypercapnic responses are strongly affected by opioids and appear to be strongly mediated in the brainstem. Alright, cardiovascular. It can cause bradycardia and hypotension. Like other opioids that can reduce adrenergic tone, fentanyl can cause vagus nerve-mediated bradycardia in addition to vasodilation and decreased sympathetic tone. Decrease in sympathetic tone and vasodilation can cause hypotension, right? Okay, gastrointestinal. It can cause anorexia, constipation, dry mouth, nausea, and vomiting. This is because of the activation of chemoreceptor in the gastrointestinal and also can cause GI motility suppression, okay? Then skin. It can cause sweating, erythema, and if you are applying transdermal, please assess the application site for any reactions. Okay, musculoskeletal. It can cause skeletal and thoracic muscle rigidity. And then it can also cause physical dependence and psychological dependence. As a critical care nurse, one of your responsibilities is to identify these adverse effects, such as assessing your patient respiration, and any interruption in respiratory rate like apnea or any signs of respiratory depression. Be alert for excessive sedation or changes in mood and behavior like confusion and restlessness, or if patient is unconscious or extremely difficult to arouse. So we need to use appropriate pain scales and implement appropriate non-pharmacological therapy techniques, physical agents, and therapeutic exercises to reduce pain and help wean patient off opioid analgesics as soon as possible. All right, now let's do some drug math. For example, your doctor may have prescribed a 50 microgram fentanyl IV bolus for a post-operative patient who is in excruciating pain. The fentanyl available is in 250 microgram per 5 ml ampule. So how many milliliters of fentanyl will you administer? The formula is, what is the formula? Desired dose divided by stock times dilution, right? Therefore, 50 microgram divided by 250 microgram times 5 ml equals to 1 ml. So as simple as that. Another example, the order is to start 100 microgram per hour IV infusion of fentanyl. The available stock provided by the pharmacy is 2,500 microgram in 50 ml normal saline in a syringe. How many ml will you run the infusion? Same formula, 100 microgram divided by 2,500 microgram times 50 ml is equal to 2 ml per hour, right? What if the physician ordered written like this? Start infusion of 0.7 microgram per kg per hour, and you have available stock of 2,500 microgram per 50 ml. How many ml will you run your infusion if your patient is weighing 75 kg? So how you calculate this? 0.7 microgram times 75 kg times 1 hour is equal to 52.5 microgram per hour, right? Therefore, the physician is asking you to infuse 52.5 microgram per hour. So how many ml will you run your infusion? So let's calculate. 52.5 microgram divided by 2,500 microgram times 50 ml is equal to 1.05 ml per hour, okay? So that's how you do the calculation. Okay, that's it for now. Thank you for watching and learning with me. Bye.